5, 4, 3, 2, 1. We are back with the PowerDrift Podcast. And like I mentioned in the previous one, we're going to talk about helmets. We've got two fancy looking helmets, very, very expensive helmets. Let's just dive right into it.
These are the world's best RIs ever made, mm-hmm. because I wear them.
Damn, no. You have to dab it. Say such thing.
No, so helmets are essential to motorcycling.
100%.
The laws exist. Yep. The enforcement doesn't. But I think as people who are listening to the PowerDrift Podcast, as people who are interested in motorcycling, I think there should be no doubt in your head that you cannot be on a motorcycle without a helmet, because the risk of injury is too great. If you're lucky, you'll just die, which just leaves behind a grieving family and all of those kind of things. But if you're unlucky, you'll become a vegetable, which means now your family has to deal with the fact that you were an idiot to not wear the helmet in the first place. Right? So think about it as a slightly bigger thing than just you and your freedom, which is this strange American idea that I can choose to not wear a helmet. Mm. Think about the impact it has on other people if you get injured.
Yeah, what annoys me the most is that people know this and yet they do not wear a helmet.
No, no, see, look, I'm okay.
Yeah.
You don't want to wear a helmet.
Yeah.
It's completely all right by me. It's no skin of my nose. Charles Darwin is my friend. Murphy is my friend. They'll take care of you. And at the end of the day, best case scenario is the gene pool, the human gene pool will become cleaner. I'm okay with this. I'm completely okay with this.
Yep.
Right? But if you want to have a long, successful, injury-free career in motorcycling, it is good for you to take precautions.
Right.
You don't need to buy an 80,000 rupee helmet.
Yeah.
You need to buy whatever you think is the safest thing you can afford at your current level and keep an eye out for when you can afford something better. Okay? The reason why I chose Arai, I used to wear Shoeys before this, and to me, Arai and Shoei are very similar in their nature and the kind of approach they have to motorcycling. It's the reason why I would tend to buy a Japanese helmet over any other kind of helmet, is because
Shoei is also Japanese, right?
Shoei is also Japanese. So why I would approach these two brands is because I think my head is extremely valuable and I would like it to be as safe as possible. What I like about these two brands is that if you look at this and I replace
Let's
this...
Let's break it down into the...
No, let's not break my helmet down.
Orangey helmet.
Let's not break it down.
I think it's orange only, no?
Yeah, it's fluorescent orange.
Fluorescent orange.
Yeah, so this helmet, if I were to take this paint pattern off and replace it with, say, Danny Pedrosa's pattern, I get Danny Pedrosa's helmet. This is what he's wearing in the race. It's not a special helmet crafted for him. The cheek liners and stuff might be to fit his head in a specific way,
right?
But this is that helmet. Okay, this Tour X4 doesn't really go to competition, but if Arai used this in a competition, it would be this shell.
This very same shell.
It's that confidence. I don't believe that Danny Pedrosa's head is more valuable than mine.
Mm.
He does put his head at bigger risks than mine because he goes faster than me at the racetrack on a regular basis.
Right.
And he gets paid for it also. So I understand why he does it. But I would want the same level of protection. So people ask me saying, hey, we've seen LS2 in MotoGP, we've seen KYT in MotoGP, etc. I would say, go find out if you can buy that helmet.
That very helmet.
That helmet. The one that the MotoGP racer uses, because that's the safest one they make.
Yeah.
And you discover that they come to this cost.
Yep, they
do. But they don't sell it on the market, because think about it. Would you buy an 80,000 rupee LS2?
No chance.
That's the point I'm making. Yeah. The point I'm making is, unfortunately, in India, price and safety, to as far as helmets are concerned, are somewhat connected. In Europe, they may not be so much, right? If you go to Sharp or ECE, it's a threshold. You have to cross the threshold, you're a great helmet, right? And a lot of cheap helmets cross ECE thresholds, just as really expensive helmets cross ECE thresholds.
Yeah.
But in India, unfortunately, it's not that state yet.
Yep.
Would you compare a Steelbird or a Vega to this? Absolutely not.
No chance.
Yes, that this is...
Have you ever worn...
I did. I wore the Vega Stealth as my first helmet and my second helmet. Yeah, then the Steelbird BFA tie-up happened, and then I was wearing BFAs for a while.
Yep.
Then the AGV tie-up and MPA, the company
correct.
That
tie-up
was there. Yeah, I've used those helmets.
Yep.
But when I got my severance pay from NIIT, when I moved to journalism, 14,000 bucks. It turns out a friend of mine bought a Shoei for himself.
Okay.
A basic Shoei, I forget the model number. And he actually wanted to sell it, and he quoted that number, the severance pay number. And from then onwards, I've never actually worn anything but a Japanese helmet.
Superb. So I have worn, I mean, when you're back in the day, when you're a teenager, you don't have a lot of pocket money. Your parents don't want to spend on an expensive helmet.
Yeah.
You're riding smaller bikes. You're okay with the idea of buying a Vega helmet.
Again, I wouldn't connect the bike size to it, but I'm saying buy what you think is the best that you can
back then,
afford
I think,
with the money that you've got.
Correct.
It could be Vega's latest. Look, they meet ICICI. They meet ICICI also because they're cheap. Right? So they meet your money requirement.
Yep.
They meet your safety standard requirement. And they meet your idea of this is safe enough. I am good with that.
Right.
Be clear about the research that you do for your helmet and buy what you think is the best you can stick your head into.
Yeah. Back then, I think the best that money could buy was an LS2 because there weren't a lot of helmet manufacturers or helmet companies in India.
Correct.
Today, the scene is different.
Yeah.
You've got a lot of people.
Yeah.
But again, the push is to always buy a helmet that's going to keep your head safe.
Correct.
And for me, again, after all these years, I will always buy a helmet which is either going to be an Arai or a Shoei.
Yeah.
Because I've seen the way these people test their helmets. And like you said, MotoGP racers who are riding motorcycles at 300 kilometers plus, they use the exact same shell.
Yes.
Which makes so much sense.
Yeah. And that's my point. My point is I do prefer Arais. Mm. I'm not saying everybody needs to get an Arai. It's ideal in the sense of safety, yes, but it's not ideal in the sense of how will anybody, a guy buying a 50,000 rupee motorcycle cannot buy an 80,000 rupee helmet. It's just stupid. That's just me, right? I'm saying figure out consciously. This is the kind of attention you'd pay to, for example, your father or mother going to hospital for treatment. You just wouldn't go to a random hospital. You'd do a little bit of research before you showed up.
Right.
You wouldn't go to a random doctor. You'd figure out who this doctor was and how good was he. In the same way, if you're a young couple, you wouldn't just use any random contraception. You'd do a little bit of research as to how you do it.
Right.
The helmets deserve the same attention. It's the same life-changing, mission-critical kind of equipment.
Absolutely.
You have to pay attention. You have to get the right one.
Yeah. So removing the safety aspect or keeping it aside, how do you actually decide on buying a helmet?
So first of all, I think the most crucial part of the helmet is the fit. At the shop, it needs to be super tight. Okay.
Yup.
Like 1 inch from painful super tight. Because if it is that, then for the next 3 or 4 years, which is the average life of a good helmet, over those next 3-4 years, it will loosen up just a little bit and become a comfortable helmet to wear.
Yeah.
You're looking for two things. One is pain points.
Yeah.
And pain points are easy to explain. This is a really comfortable helmet, as is that one. They have a liner which opens here a little bit. You just stick 2 ear plugs in it. And that's just foam, right?
Yeah.
Those ear plugs. I will go from here 16 kilometers later, I have a massive freaking headache because that's a pressure point. Right?
Oh, okay.
You remove the earplugs and within 5 minutes, the headache is gone. That's a pressure point.
All
so you want to walk around in the shop for about 10 odd minutes just to see if any pressure points are showing up. If they don't and you take off the helmet, but there is a pronounced red spot here or a red spot here, you know that something in the helmet shell is not working with your head shape.
Mm-hmm.
That's one. Second, it has to be as tight as possible, but it has to be, it'll do this. And this is okay. Okay, so if you're walking around the shop with your cheeks
just gonna
up
get
like
to
this,
that, yeah.
That's completely okay. What you're looking for is when you move the helmet like this, your cheek skin moves with the helmet.
Yep.
But the helmet itself
shouldn't
be able to move around and your head is flopping around inside is not a good helmet.
Yeah.
Why? Because the helmet has a shell outside. It's got effectively a thermocol liner. It's not just a basic thermocol liner anymore. Both of these and most of the better helmets use multiple densities of thermocol. EPS expanded polystyrene is effectively thermocol, right? And what happens is as the helmet reaches a solid thing, for example, a curb stone or a pole, poles are super dangerous. Your shell tries to spread the impact as
energy
as large of space of the helmet as possible, and your head is now compressing the thermocol liner, which is how you are decelerating, different from the helmet's rate of deceleration.
Correct. Absolutely.
Now, if you know the formula for deceleration, you'd realize that if a helmet traveling at 30 kmph comes to a stop by hitting, say, the side of a footpath,
like a sudden stop,
this sudden stop is happening at a microsecond scale. It is happening over the distance, which is measurable in like decimals of millimeters.
Right.
When you put that in the denominator of the acceleration formula, you get idiotic numbers like 3500G, 6000G.
Yep.
So your head effectively is now being forced to absorb 3500G if you're not wearing a helmet. Okay? Now, what that means is your skull stops because it's a hard object, but your gray matter, which is a soft object, has now basically like an ocean wave is sloshing against it.
Yep.
So the fact is it can't keep its structure together, which is where you get brain injuries from.
Concussions happen as well.
Yeah. So what this does is add the crucial 1-2 centimeters of expansion space, which gives you better things in the denominator of that formula and reduces that to 150G.
Yeah. Yep.
Now, it was hard for me to understand it the first time I read it, but 150G is a concussion. It's survivable.
Uh-huh.
75G is a bad headache, but you'll survive it.
What?
Yeah. But 3500G, no chance, right?
No chance.
What you're looking for these things to do is to be able to slow down the rate at which your gray matter decelerates in the event of a crash.
Right.
For that, the thermocol liner is essential.
Right.
Now imagine this, you have a loose helmet. Remember this discussion about why tight helmets. If you have loose, first your face slaps into the thermocol.
Mm-hmm.
You've already lost time.
Yep.
because the helmet has already stopped moving, right?
Yep.
It stopped moving and my head is still moving into it,
yep.
which means I still have space for that enormous acceleration to play out,
yep.
which is why you want the shell to fit as tightly around your face as possible, yeah. so that once the impact happens, the thermocol can immediately start doing its job rather than wasting any time.
Yeah, because that's how I choose my helmets as well. Unfortunately, I haven't had the privilege of actually trying it in a shop because helmets get shipped.
Right.
But I always ask for one size smaller.
Mm.
What really happens is I wear it on day one. After, say, riding for about 30 kilometers, there's a bit of pain going around in the head. That pain eventually stops after 3 or 4 days.
Right.
But after that, the helmet is still snug. I always want the cheeks to be a little tight.
Mm.
Because as you said, over yeah. the course of 2 or 3 years, the liner always starts to wear out. And
yeah.
when it starts to wear out, the helmet starts to move around a fair bit. That is also when you decide to change your liners.
Right.
Especially with the speeds that we do.
Yeah.
You want the helmet to stay steady.
Yeah.
You are ducked down, you're going at, say, a BIC back straight and you get up at 300 kilometers per hour. You don't want your head to move around.
Oh, I'll give you a better example.
Yeah.
Yamaha had organized a ride from Delhi to Jaipur on a bunch of superbikes many years ago. And we all got to the first toll booth or whatever, and I was already on the show by that point of time.
What were you riding?
R6, I think. The new R6, the updated R6. Yeah, this was just a general random group of superbikes. No plan to launch them.
Yeah.
It was just a thing.
Yeah.
We all took off our helmets and everybody had a red nose because their AGV, BFAs, whatever was sitting on their noses as they were going fast.
Yeah.
But when I took off the Arai, I think Adil already had done, I took off my Shoei. Adil also had a Shoei. We both took our helmets off and there was like the print that you get from the liners, but there was no red spot.
Yeah.
And they all looked at me and said, hey, how come your nose isn't red? I said, my Shoei is not sitting on my nose the whole time, right? That's the difference. Even on a public road, you don't need to go to a racetrack to appreciate the qualities of a good helmet.
Yeah. Also, what I want from my helmet is clear vision.
Yeah.
So I've worn a Shoei before. I've also worn an AGV. In an AGV, I'll always see the beak.
Yeah.
The Shoei is a little long.
Yeah.
So you'll always see the beak.
Yeah.
In an Arai as well, in the RX-7 GP that I have, the golden helmet that people see in PowerDrift videos, I can always see the opening of the visor.
Hmm.
I would ideally not want that. I have not faced that problem with an HJC ever.
Right.
Like an Alpha 11, I've not faced that. And I want clear vision on the sides, on the top.
Yeah.
But with an Arai, I'll always see that.
Right.
I've gotten accustomed to it. But with the Shoei, I'll probably never get to it because I've always seen, I'll always keep seeing that.
Yeah, I think as far as I understand it, the helmet makers do struggle with how to make the eye port.
Yeah.
Because the smaller you make the chin bar, the more vision I give you. But the more vision I give you, the weaker the chin bar is.
Yes.
And how do you raise this height? Mm. So this helmet, I think there was a lot of work done on the shell so that this temple area where the shell, the thing used to actually come up here, the shield.
The shield
mount has moved lower. Yeah. So you get a lot more coverage on the temple, but the eye port is actually larger. So this is actually quite a good helmet to wear. Yeah.
Just to let people know, this is the Arai RX-7V.
This is the RX-7V and that's the Tour X4.
It's also known as the RX-7X.
And that is called the Tour XD3 or something like that in certain markets.
In case you people get inspired in buying a helmet after seeing this podcast, you're most free to do that.
So the thing is, first consideration is a snug fit. Mm. Second consideration is your retention mechanism, which is how the helmet stays on your head. The cheaper helmets usually have a ratchet.
Yep.
The thing with the ratchet is it's not an unsafe system by any means, but you want to adjust it so that the chin strap sits firmly at here, not here.
Correct.
Here.
Yep.
And when it sits here, the idea is you shouldn't be able to pull it over your chin like this because then the helmet can just come off in a crash.
Yep.
But that tightening has to be done. And we've seen it at the racetrack. When we're doing the gear check before people go out onto the track, it's dangling here, which means if it falls, this helmet will just come off.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the ratchet's issue is that most people are too lazy to adjust it. And therefore, there is a chance that you're still not having a retention system that works on your helmet once you get one.
Yeah. Yeah.
The D-ring thing is that the D-ring cannot be worn unless it's tight. So you have to pull it tight to be able to use it.
Yeah.
That's why most of the expensive helmets use D-rings. They are fiddly the first few times and you do get used to putting them on. I can put them on with gloves today, but it's
really?
Like, yeah.
I can never do that.
Yeah,
with
so
gloves,
you get used to it. Yeah. Some people will put on the gloves after they put on the helmet.
Yeah.
I can do both. Yeah. So in the middle of a shoot where we do a lot of helmet taking off and helmet putting on for
you
shots.
Just keep your gloves on.
Yeah, it's fine.
I think a good example of that is the camera angle that faces MotoGP riders.
Yeah.
When they're turning their head, you can actually see the
strap
firmly to the chin.
And the third thing I would say is pay attention to the certification. Okay, there are two kinds of certification. I'm going to wrap this up because this is becoming a really long discussion on helmets, as important as they are. Certification, remember that there are honor systems and certification systems. Okay, the honor systems are like DOT and currently the ISI. It's not moved to the certification system yet, where the helmet manufacturer has to certify that they are able to prove that the helmet meets the standard. There is no third party that comes in, figures this out, apart from surprise inspections by people like the BIS or the Department of Transportation in the United States.
Right.
So to me, the DOT is a brand that is on stamped onto a helmet, but it's not always a guarantee of the greatest helmet ever.
Right.
For that, you need a third party certified standard like
what
ECE.
Would be a good example? Yep, ECE.
Like ECE. Yep. So ECE 2205, which is I think the latest version, is the most complicated helmet law there is. It is enforced by third party labs where you have to go pay quite a bit of money to get your certifications done. And if you see a helmet with an ECE stamp, I would stand behind that. I would say, yes, this is a good helmet. I'm not a fan of Sharp so much because Sharp takes into consideration things like safety and all of that.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's nice for the usability of a helmet, but I want a safety rating. I think not comfort I can figure out on my own.
Yep.
Yeah. So I'm not such a fan of Sharp. I understand there are people who prefer it. That's great. Go for it. Find a certification that works for you. Just like I said, find a price and a helmet that works for you. Find those things and get going.
But I think the A grade or the gold standard of certification is going to be ECE.
I would say ECE 2205. A lot of people also pay a lot of attention to SNELL because it's a completely third party, non-profit certification. Most helmets that are intended for race use will anyway have both ECE and SNELL. Like this one is a SNELL certified. I don't remember if this one is, but I think it is also. And SNELL is a third party standard. You'll have to look inside.
The
SNELL thing sticker is in here somewhere. Right. The third thing I wanted to talk about, since you turned the helmet around, turn it around again, is stickers. Okay? We get a lot of questions about, I want to sticker my helmet, wrap my helmet, paint my helmet, there's art on my helmet. Let's be very clear about this. 99% of helmets cannot handle stickers. They are not designed to do it.
Do not sticker your helmet.
And a wrap is just a very large sticker, so don't do it at all.
Do not.
They are not, you should not paint them because 99% of people who are painting helmets, especially in India, don't know what chemicals to use. And this whole game is about chemicals, okay? These shells are chemically sensitive. By nature, you want to be very sure about what to put on it. So most of the time, these helmets are cleaned with extremely diluted soap and water. And that's all I've done for the last 19 years. You don't need to buy fancy sprays. Although the sprays are usually helmet safe.
Yeah.
In UK, the last time I was in a shop, there were stickers marked helmet safe, which means that the adhesive was designed not to react with the shell's material.
Yep.
So that eventually, if you have a crash, the helmet shouldn't fail because the adhesive weakened the shell out. That's why you don't want to put anything on top of your helmet. So there's a safe place to put shit on a helmet. Okay. And I'm going to call it shit because I think it is shit. Mm. This is a plastic panel, for example. This is a vent. This vent has no structural function. You want to sticker this up, go for it. It doesn't really affect the helmet in any way. This peak is also a non-structural element which will break off in a crash. Go ahead and sticker it. Put your GoPro mount here.
Yeah.
The GoPro mount is a choice that you are making. It does make the helmet less round, which means you could possibly get a neck injury out of it. But that's your neck. Put it wherever the hell you want. I don't have a problem with it. The rubber liner here at the bottom, this is a very thin one, but most helmets have a much larger rubber liner.
Yeah.
Go ahead and put a sticker on that. Not a structural part of the helmet, but leave the shell alone unless the manufacturer tells you otherwise.
Yeah.
In this case, both of these helmets come with copy in the manual from RI that says it's okay to sticker these helmets up.
Yeah, I think we need to read
that. So this number 13 is from the Triumph Scrambler launch where the race number was 13 for this real small thing that we did there. I came last. So the number 13 is okay on my helmet because RI says it's all right to sticker this helmet up.
Yeah.
I'm still not a fan, but it was okay when they wanted to put my race number up.
Just like a motorcycle manual is not read too often, a helmet manual is never read.
Yeah, so next time you want to modify your helmet, first of all, desist. Helmets are not things that you modify. Second of all, pay attention to whether your helmet can handle it or not. If you want to put a sticker here at the edge of your shield, it's fine. It's not going to affect your vision really.
Right.
If you want to put it on this panel here, which basically holds the retention mechanism of the visor together, go for it. Knock yourself out.
Yeah.
When you touch the shell, be super careful. Get a helmet that can handle it or find somebody who knows what adhesives to put.
Yeah. Superb. Before we close this podcast, one more thing. A lot of these helmets actually come with a removable cheek liner in case you meet with a crash.
Yes.
Look out in case your friend meets with a crash or someone you know meets with a crash. Look out for the inside of the liner where it says it's removable.
Correct.
And that is where you pluck it out and remove the helmet safely.
So when I did the first training program, one of the first things you do when you reach an injury site is stabilize the neck.
Right.
Because if there is a neck injury or a spinal injury of any sort, you can really aggravate it and make it very serious very fast.
Yep.
Removing a helmet as the first reaction to a crash is one of those actions. It's reflexive to most humans.
Right.
So we immediately go there, but it's the most dangerous thing you can do. So now some of the better helmets, and I'll show you this. It's actually, I've got the chin bar in, so you can't see the other one. It's easier on the other one, I think. So you can see the orange tabs. Yeah, so the orange tabs basically tell you that there is a emergency release. You pull it down and the cheek pads will basically fall out of the helmet. Right. And now there is nothing holding your head in, so you can just slide it out.
Yep.
There are safer, there are other ways to do it. Just look up YouTube. There are a couple of really, really good videos that we haven't made, somebody else has made, where the guy shows you how to stabilize the neck so that you can slide the thing off. The trick is that when you're stabilizing the neck, you need to get your hand inside the helmet so that you can hold the neck from the inside as the helmet is slowly pulled off the head.
Yep.
But anytime your friend falls,
do
not rush to remove the helmet.
Yeah.
If they need to breathe, open the visor as gently as you can and you're good.
Yep.
The removing of the helmet is a big decision in the process of fixing somebody's problems after a crash.
Yeah.
Either they do it themselves, in which case they're conscious of any pains or aches, or you do it with training, or you wait for somebody with training to come.
Yeah. Just to add to that, very, very quickly, once you crash, the helmet's gone.
Once you crash, 3 years later for cheap helmets, 2 years later for cheap helmets, 3 years later for medium price helmets, 5 years for really good helmets.
Yeah.
Helmets are done. They have a shelf life, just like your medicines in your first aid kit.
Yep.
Check those two. Check these two. Okay. These two helmets are both, I'm very lucky. This is about 8 months old. This is 3-4 months old. So I still have four and a half years to work with these helmets, unless I crash them, of course. Go ahead and remove these helmets from your active duty cycle once they are done.
Yep.
If you get a small scratch on the shell, you want to get it evaluated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. In my case, I fell off my Triumph, my Street Triple. I had a small scratch here, which was mostly on the vent, and a little piece touched the shell. And I was ready to retire it. But the guys who represent RI in India, that's Vicky Jaisingh at Performance Racing, he said, no, wait, wait, don't panic. Just send me a photograph first.
Yeah.
They sent him a photograph. They sent it to RI, and RI wrote back saying, it doesn't look like anything has happened. The
vent is broken.
We'll send you a vent back.
Okay.
You will see this little
scratch,
but it's basically chipped paint more than anything else. You can go ahead and use that helmet.
Yeah.
Also, when you keep helmets down, be super careful, okay? I am very confident of this table because we are not touching the table. It's a requirement from the podcast guys saying, you keep touching the table, the sound gets interrupted. So I'm very happy with the helmets are here.
Yeah.
Normally, my helmets sit on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
They sit on the ground because you can't possibly have a helmet fall off the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah, the earth isn't flat, unfortunately. So there's no edge to fall off, right?
Yeah.
You don't want to keep your helmet on the top of a bike seat. I do that for my videos when I'm doing PTCs. There will be helmets on seats, but they're super carefully kept.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're secured to the bike, so they can't actually roll off.
Roll off, yeah.
But when your helmet rolls off, remember, you will damage the shell, but you may not have damaged the EPS liner. So you might be able to still continue to use the helmet.
Right.
But if you're dropping the helmet regularly, there was one genius on my Instagram who wrote to me saying, I dropped my helmet 3 times from my bike seat. How the hell did you do that, man?
Slow clap.
He said, no, the first time was me. The second time was my friend. The third time was my other friend.
What?
What kind of friends are you riding with?
And I even survived.
What kind of friends are you riding with? How come they keep knocking your helmet off?
Wow.
Yeah. Point is, yes, I also got one idiot who said, helmet on the ground means rider is dead. So please keep your helmet elsewhere.
Yeah, I read that on your story.
And I'm going to say, I don't really give a shit what the symbolism is. My helmet goes on the ground because it can't possibly fall off and get damaged by it. And 19 years later, I have still yet to drop a helmet off a thing.
Yeah.
I've fallen off inside helmets.
Yeah. But not like in...
But I have not dropped a helmet yet. And I think I'm good with that.
Yeah. Superb. I think with that very insightful information from you, I think we'll call a close on this podcast as well. There are a lot more episodes that are going to flow your way very, very soon. If you want to hear about something, please let us know in the comment section below. And like, share, subscribe to PowerDrift.
Yeah, and tell your friends that there are two guys who are dissing everybody who knows everything about helmets on the PowerDrift podcast.
Hate DMs on Instagram.
We love the hate DMs because it's so good content for us. No, I'm serious. Take your helmet seriously. They are the most protective equipment you will buy. They protect the most vital part of who you are as a human being.
Yeah.
They protect the part that will cause you the worst trouble if you're not careful.
Right.
So it doesn't matter if you're going to the shops or the haircut or the racetrack. A helmet is an essential. Get the best one you can afford because you do value your head, right? If you don't value your head, it doesn't matter anymore.
Yeah, so the RIs come from Japan, which means they cost a lot less there, a lot more in India.
Yes.
So if there's someone, a friend of yours who's traveling to Japan,
yes,
please ask them to get...
Yeah, so Japan is a good place to get RIs.
Or Shoeys. Yeah.
Or Shoeys. America also, because they have a lot of discounting that happens on old stock. Be careful when you're buying old stock. You want to check what the manufacturing date was.
Is, yeah.
But usually the shelf life of helmets are actually quite good. So you shouldn't have to worry too much.
Yeah.
In India, Performance Racing is the official distributor.
Yeah.
And these are expensive helmets. I think that's about 55 to start with. And this is about 75, something like that.
Yeah.
But don't look at it as, oh man, he's wearing expensive helmets. Yeah. Think about it like this. Hmm. This head is worth at least 2 crores as far as I'm concerned. Maybe
priceless. Yeah.
Why would I wear a cheap helmet?
Yeah.
Have you seen this? The moneymaker. And on that note, I think we'll call the podcast.
I think the Shubhaprata Express has reached its station.
Yes.
I think we're going to call it a bye-bye. Ciao, like Rohan says. I'm going to say this always. Like Rohan says, ciao.
I'll see you later. Bye.